I got sick at 25, and my birthday was the following week, and I honestly didn't know if I would make it to 26.
Blood clots don't respect age, sex, race, ethnicity.
One minute I was actually fine, laughing, joking, having a good time. The next minute, my breathing had changed dramatically.
This is getting bad. I feel like I don't want to die in my sleep or something like that.
The scariest part really is the unknown.
It could have been very catastrophic for me.
We know that when you are involved in your care, when you actively participate, it's more rewarding for you, you have a better experience, and most importantly, you have better outcomes. And we need you to be involved. And one important area for you to be involved with is the prevention of blood clots. Blood clots are one of the major causes of preventable harm in healthcare. Indeed, we think about 100,000 people die from these every year. And with the right therapies, they're largely preventable.
My blood clot was actually a result of having surgery following the hip fracture. And the way it was described to me is because the hip fracture, it's such a large bone, and whenever you have a large bone fracture and surgery, you're at risk for developing a deep vein thrombosis.
I was out doing some yard work, and I noticed I was having more shortness of breath. I mean, given my history of being pretty healthy, it was really easy for me to just say it's nothing serious.
It's a typical guy thing. I hurt like hell all over my neck, shoulders, back, and chest. And as I tried to breathe, it felt like something was being stuck into my lungs.
My friends and I were traveling to Southeast Asia for a month. Toward the end of the trip, I started to feel all of a sudden a swelling and a pain in my leg.
All of a sudden, I began to labor with my breathing. It was very difficult for me to breathe, and I couldn't understand what was wrong with me. Little did I know that it was the onset of blood clots that had traveled from my legs up to my lungs.
Deep vein thrombosis is a blood clot in the leg, and thrombosis is a clot. And what can happen is that clot can break off from the vein in the leg, travel through the body to the lung, and when it does that, that's what's called a pulmonary embolism, or a PE.
It's deadly in about 10% of cases, and so it's very important to prevent that blood clot from developing in the legs so that pulmonary embolism cannot happen.
I had developed a blood clot from my ankle all the way nearly up to my heart. One long, 4-foot-long blood clot. I also learned that I had multiple blood clots in both lungs, and that it was pretty much a miracle that I had survived.
They had done some more tests. They did blood work, and the blood work showed that my D-dimer level was elevated.
So there are many different tests we can order as physicians to help determine if you have a blood clot. Sometimes we'll do a blood test called a D-dimer, which can help tell if you have a blood clot in your body. If we think you have a blood clot in your leg, we will likely order a duplex ultrasound and watch the blood flow and make sure we can see the blood flowing normally. If we're worried that you have a pulmonary embolism or a blood clot in the lung, we will most likely order a CAT scan of the chest, and we can actually look at the blood vessels within the lung and see if there's a clot in one of those vessels.
When I was finally diagnosed with a clot, the first step is to use what's called low molecular weight heparin. The drug name is Lovenox. I stayed on Lovenox for about 2.5 weeks, even after I got out of the hospital.
Blood clot was very severe, and I didn't get the treatment that was necessary to really destroy that entire 4-foot-long blood clot. And I wish that I knew then what I know today, so I could have immediately sought the necessary treatment. I could have actually avoided the entire experience.
The reason everyone in the hospital is at risk of getting a blood clot is because it means you're sick. You've got some problem going on that leads you to be in the hospital, and there's so many things that are associated with getting blood clots. So surgery is a well-known risk factor. Trauma, orthopedic surgery, hip and knee replacement, for example, are one of the highest risk factors. But also anybody with heart disease, lung disease, pregnancy, or women who are postpartum just having had babies. All these things put you at significantly elevated risk for deep vein thrombosis and pulmonary embolism.
I was in the hospital for a radical prostatectomy and bladder repair. I left the hospital and I went home. A few days later, I discovered I was having some pain in my right side. The pain progressed as the day went on. So I left and I went to the emergency room, and that's when they discovered that I had a blood clot in my right lower lung.
Many patients, when they are admitted to the hospital, are at a really high risk of developing a clot in their leg, and that could eventually loosen and go into your lungs and cause you to have serious complications, even death.
Some patients are at higher risk than others, and our job as physicians is to figure out what your risk is and suggest to you what the best medications or other prevention treatments we have to help prevent blood clots are.
The preferred technique is to use drugs that thin the blood, that prevent blood clots from forming. And generally we administer these with a needle under the skin.
Take it the way the physicians and the nurses and the pharmacists advise, because it's all that's standing between you and a coffin.
There are also mechanical devices, some compression stockings that squeeze your legs, and those might be right for many patients as well.
The squeezy boots, those mechanical devices to prevent blood from collecting in the legs, keep them on, and if they get up and go to the bathroom, when they get back into bed, put the devices back on, or actually call the nurse to put them back on.
When you go for a walk around the ward, that is excellent. We encourage as much ambulation as possible, but that's not enough when you're in the hospital. We want you wearing these at all times to help prevent those clots.
I made sure every time I was laying down that I had not only the compression stockings on, but the compression boot, because I understood the importance of it.
And I did what they told me to do. I never argued with them or tried to be more doctor than they were.
So often, both physicians and nurses will offer different literature to you.
We have this one-page fast facts, we call it, that you can read through if you'd like, or I can go over some of that with you. You might even want to share this with your family so that they understand why you're getting these injections every day while you're in the hospital.
After I left the hospital, I had the Levonox injections that I had to take for a week.
When I first realized that I'd had to give myself Levonox injections, that was a little bit nerve-wracking for me because I don't like needles. But after I practiced with the nurse in the hospital, I was able to give myself self-injections.
I'm one of those kind of people that, you know, I don't like to take medicine unless I absolutely have to. And the fact that I have to be on this for the rest of my life doesn't bother me nearly as much when I weigh the risks of getting another blood clot.
There is a message of hope there, because I was stubborn and doctors told me I would never be able to run again, but I went to the gym every day. I started running, and I actually ran the New York City Marathon 3 months ago, 2 years after that blood clot, 2 years after I was in a wheelchair. I think there are a few things you can do to avoid getting a blood clot.
Be as involved in your care as you can. This is your body.
Put those compression stockings on. Put those compression boots on.
Take your injections.
I think it would be a terrible, terrible shame to not do as your doctor says, to not take the medicine as you've been told to take, because for such a small price, you can avoid months and years and a lifetime of pain and hardship.
Blood clots kill 100,000 patients per year. And if you think about it, that's more than AIDS, breast cancer, and motor vehicle collisions all combined. It's a huge problem in America.
I have heard about so many people after my situation who weren't as fortunate and who died from clotting almost immediately. I was very fortunate, and I feel fortunate every day that I'm here.
So you've heard a lot of information. What we want you to leave with is the understanding that when we work together, you're going to have better outcomes. And to prevent blood clots, the main things you need to do are make sure that you're screened to determine your risk for blood clots, and that every day you receive the right therapies to prevent those blood clots. Together, we can help ensure you have the best care possible.